Yeah, hi, welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yakov David Cohen. I'm here with a very special guest, Princess Maria Amar from the Philippines, who's a very welcome guest. And she's not only gracious to honor us with her visit, she has an organization promoting We Care for Humanity, promoting human rights,
world peace,
and goodness and kindness. Please tell us a little about yourself.
First of all, thank you so much, Rabbi Yakov, for inviting me to your show. And I heard a lot of great things about this show. So when you asked me to be part of this, I got so excited.
Well, you're going to be aired in 1.5 million throughout the world. But
wow,
and the whole New York. The whole New York's going to stop.
Awesome. Yeah. So anyways, talking about my organization, We Care for Humanity, it was founded in 2011 and it's based in California. It's basically an international organization because we have chapters in different parts of the world like Nigeria, Malaysia, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, India. We have in Morocco, Mauritius, Uganda, Kenya, and we're working on other countries as well. Of course, Philippines, where I came from.
And what's your primary, what's your goal? What's your target?
The organization's mission is to promote universal humanitarianism and, of course, to convert every human being into becoming a humanitarian. So it's quite a big task, but we're trying our best every day.
You know, it's interesting because in Judaism, we have a metaphor for light, for goodness as for light, and darkness, evil.
Right.
And the interesting thing is that with a candle, no matter how many times you light it, when you light another candle, it in turn lights another candle and it goes on forever.
Yeah, so the vision is to have ripple effect of kindness and humanitarianism. So if we promote one humanitarian, two humanitarian, it will replicate, it will multiply. So that's our mission is to promote universal humanitarianism. And we also advocate different global issues like education, health, world peace, human rights, eradication of poverty, green environment, and women empowerment.
Let's talk about some of them or some of your experiences as a princess who's not interested in just sitting in a palace but actually helping people.
Well, I do believe that the royal families or royal members should be the first to promote humanitarianism. They were, if we would go back to the history of royalty, they were elected by the people to govern their community or their kingdom. And this is like government, the government now used to be monarchy before. And it's the same thing, you're serving humanity, you're serving people. So. Contrary to the thinking of other people that royalty should be sitting in palace, no, I think they should be the one who should be out there and serving as role models and actually doing the dirty work, giving donations or doing something for the people.
So you traveled extensively throughout the world.
Yes, because of our program, which is the Traveling Princess, the concept is to find the greatest humanitarians of the world, which is also integrated to our humanitarian awards called the Global Officials of Dignity Awards.
Which stands for G-O-D, right?
G-O-D,
which is actually...
I know, it's questionable. People are asking.
Well, the way you write it, actually, you write it with... G.O.D., which is not a problem.
Yeah.
In Judaism, you can't write the word G-O-D.
Yes.
We have to put a dash because it's a holy name.
Well, it was the purpose of having the acronym of G-O-D is it catches attention.
Yeah.
And yes, I got some kind of some punches here and there that, you know, it's... Our awards is sort of religious or something.
No.
I said, no. It's an acronym for Global Officials of Dignity Awards.
But I think it's more than that. It's something which, you know, this show is primarily geared to all people. It's called One People, One World.
In a way, it's godly.
It's godly. And we emulate God.
Yes. And
by doing good.
We're doing, purpose is to serve humanitarianism, which is a godly thing, right. A noble thing to do. So, yeah, and I'm glad with the name. We've been carrying that for 4 years already.
We met actually in the United Nations a few years ago, and you know, I've been very impressed with your work and your steadfast commitment to make change and to bring about change, which is really, really what it's about, making a difference.
Thank you so much. You know, as an NGO, you're an NGO.
Right.
It's really a big, shall I say, not competition. We don't want to compete. We actually want to work with different NGOs.
Everyone is
but
working.
To have your NGO survive, because there are many obstacles and challenges, one must be so focused to the aim and the goals of the organization. So in my case, in my organization, I give almost 100% of my time, of myself, to the organization, because we have a bigger vision. You have to think of that. You have to that's why a commitment is very important. And we have a lot of ambassadors and volunteers working with We Care for Humanity, and they too give, you know, their time and their hard work, their efforts in spreading humanitarianism.
It's we, if anybody wants the website, it's
wecareforhumanity.org.
Right.
And also, I have my personal page. If they want to contact me, it's princessmariaamor.com.
You want to spell that?
Princess Maria, M-A-R-I-A, and Amor, A-M-O-R.com. And we are on social media, very big on social media. We have so many pages. We're on LinkedIn as well and Twitter. And we have our TV show coming up at Mana TV and TV5. That's going to be the Human Eye TV and the Princess Maria Amor, the Traveling Princess.
The Traveling Princess.
Yes.
And it's not all about, it's about doing good. Tell us about some of your travels and some of the people you met. I'm sure you have some fascinating.
You've been to South Korea, right?
I've been to South Korea
for the World Peace
for the World Peace Conference.
WARP Summit.
Yeah, it was actually
Manili.
Yeah, it was actually about a year and a half ago. A few months ago.
Well, see, I travel for the purpose of, like I said, finding the greatest humanitarians of the world. So either we attend this kind of events, which has a lot of social impact on peace, on human rights. And then I try to associate it with some humanitarian works along the way. But most of my travels also geared into humanitarian works, like humanitarian aids to some countries, especially developing countries. We just recently launched the first annual Operation Global Santa, where our aim is to make this needy children happy during, especially holiday season, because we want everyone, all these children, to feel special and happy. So in 8 countries, we send donations from different parts of the world. We have in Kenya, we held it in Malaysia, in Bangladesh, in the Philippines, in India, 4 cities in India, in Colombia, and Pakistan. So that's 7 already, 7 countries I mentioned. There's another country. But this is our first launching, but we successfully executed the Operation Global Santa, and we're counting on by next year, the next Christmas, we will be able to help more children in more countries. So those are some of the trips. And some of the trips were personal invitations from, official invitations from some of them, dignitaries and royalty, to do humanitarian works as well.
I think that's very, very important, because at the end of the day, you know, the story of our organization is called the Institute of Noahide Code,
which comes
from the story of Noah.
All right, I'm very familiar with that, and I'm very familiar with the Noahide
code, the seven laws, right,
which I am. I respect that a lot. I think that what you have is the summary of what people should really follow. It's like if the Christians have the Ten Commandments, the Noahide has seven, which and covers everything.
It really already. Comes from, it's really before any religion, mm-hmm. we were all, even the Jewish people for that matter, were children of Noah. So we're all a child of Noah, meaning we all
came from him.
This
is the Ark of Noah,
right? So we survived the great flood, and this is a means, the first one, believing in God. Mm-hmm. So whether you pray through whichever religion, obviously to pray to the one and only God. How you address him, mm-hmm. or how is totally, you know, or you're more emotional or more, some people are more musical, talented.
Yeah, God comes in any form or any name or any given name.
Well, but it's 70 nations coming together as one.
Right.
It's 70 people. And that's what it's all about, coming together and finding that common thread that unites us all. So Noah, you know, being that survivor of the flood, mm-hmm. you know, is a way to bring peace. And it's finding that commonality.
Yes, and I totally support that, and hopefully that we'll be able to spread the seven laws of Noah.
Yes. You know, it's interesting.
It's important to attain peace in this world. We must have, first of all, the belief in God.
Right.
Because without your faith in God, it would be very hard for us to have inner peace.
Right.
And you know, if you don't have inner peace, so how can you have peace with other people?
Right. And the second one is to respect God, to have a relationship with God, and to pray in some sort of connect to God, mm-hmm. to be thankful for what you have.
Communication is very important.
Right.
And if you believe in God, it's just natural that you're communicating with Him. But you know, with respect, it's how we live our life. Without respect, without certain regard for everything in this world, like life and there will be chaos.
Very true.
Yeah.
And in respect for human life, thou shalt not murder. In respect to family, thou shalt not steal.
I believe that no one has the right to take other people's lives, you know.
The only time in the Torah law which you're allowed to kill is when someone's coming to kill you, you're allowed to kill them.
So what do you say about when the lawmakers are...
No, but there's also war when someone...
The war, definitely.
War is
like a mass, execution.
Well, wars, again, some wars have been started out of aggression, but at the end of the day,
isn't it sad some of the wars and mass execution are being decided by one person?
It's very sad.
One person or one or group of people. I mean, our fate lies on some one person alone or individual. With
that's why it's important that even royalty, for that matter, realizes that they have a higher authority. You know, we refer to God as King of Kings. Mm-hmm. He's not only the King of...
He's the King of Kings. Yeah.
So even a king, although he's not above the law.
Right.
A king, is still accountable and can't just do whatever he wants. You know,
there's only one king.
Right. There's the King of Kings. Yeah, the King of Kings.
Some of us are lucky to be given the title King on this earth, but still, that doesn't give anybody right to take lives or to decide on the lives of others. I think that their authority is the boundaries is to just take care of the welfare of their people.
Right.
That's it. But not that people's lives will depend on their hands, or people's fate will depend on their hands.
I'm very impressed to see that you have this vision, you know, and this outlook, which, you know, some people don't realize it. You know, when they have, they say there's a saying, absolute power corrupts absolutely, but you're obviously the exception, because you have that global outlook and that humanitarian.
Thank you. And I, like I mentioned, I do believe that every person was given that power or position or title. They should use that authority and influence and power for the right reasons. And if you don't, then it's basically useless. It's just a title with no impact of goodness to society. These dignitaries and diplomats and royalty, they should be the one leading the people, leading humanity, because they are given duties to do something for humanity. They're not just figures, not to be just a princess or a prince or some kind of, you know, a trophy. You know, we're not trophy. We're supposed to do something. That's how you portray the title. If everyone can do that, I think we will have a better world.
And I think if we all shared, you know, looked at the world as a boat, meaning we're all in this together.
We're all in this together. We're all brothers and sisters.
Right.
Regardless of creed, color.
Right. Everyone is created in the divine.
And everyone's equal. There's no royalty. There's no.
No. God. Everyone. God gave.
Created.
Everyone. Yeah. Everyone. I wouldn't say the word equal. I would say we're all created for a special. It's like apples and oranges. Each one has their tasks.
But not in that sense.
But you know, we don't all have to be apples to enjoy it.
No, we have our given tasks.
Like they say, men and women today in the world, everyone wants to say men should be, women should do the jobs of men.
But
men
equal in a sense.
I think we have different tasks.
Yeah.
I think God created everyone, every individual, unique.
Mm-hmm.
Men are unique. Women are unique.
Correct.
Women don't have to drive a tractor trailer, or shoot be a fighter pilot. to prove their role. Their role is unique. In Judaism, the woman has a central role in the house. And that's a unique role which only a woman could nurture.
Correct. No, I do agree with you. It's also anatomically there are things that we can't do and men cannot do.
Right.
But also, touching the human rights issue or gender equality, when it comes to, say, for example, issues of jobs or salaries and that, violence, you know, everyone should be equal in a sense that we do not discriminate women.
No, 100%. That I agree. That's, in a way,
right.
Women should.
Yes, yeah, I mean, biologically, anatomically, we bear children.
Right.
You don't.
Right.
So, I mean, those things, we understand what are the roles of women and, you know, the capacity and ability of the body and the minds,
and
psychologically, emotionally, mentally. However, on other issues affecting the society, you know, economically, politically.
No, there shouldn't be two sets of laws.
No, and that's what I meant.
Yeah,
everybody's equal.
Yeah, no, and no two sets of laws for you know, two bathrooms or two for different race, and that's also discrimination.
No, that could be separated for the.
No, I'm talking about discrimination between white and blacks.
Oh yes,
you know, that's also But men should have men's bathrooms and women should have women's bathrooms. And
let's not either way, they can pick it up.
And each one should have each one should have their role. That's we could agree. You know, I think that's that's very it's very refreshing to hear that you agree and see this as a you know not to. So let me hear some of any interesting.
Interesting is we are having an Global Officials of Dignity Awards again this coming middle of the year. Hopefully, we don't have the final dates yet, But it's definitely happening. And the We Care for Humanity Humanitarian Summit, which we're incorporating with innovations right now. And a lot of things are really happening good out there. I'm excited about our TVs. We have a lot of publicity ambassadors for We Care for Humanity from different parts of the world. They speak in their own language, which is so exciting. I mean, I love what I'm doing. I love being working for We Care for Humanity, especially that I founded it, and it has grown so much in such a short time. We encountered a lot of challenges, though, but that's part of life. That's part of growing. So
you want to talk about some of the challenges?
I don't know. You know, it's not a secret what happened last event we had, that we were a victim of political issues.
Oh, let's not talk about that.
We're not going to talk about that.
Yeah, let's
but
talk
challenges.
About, let's, no, let's see some of the challenges that you've overcome. For instance, how do you get countries from, you said Pakistan, just different religions and different cultures, how do you bring them together? I mean, that's a challenge in itself, bringing...
Yes. Foundation is humanitarianism. It would be hard if it's a collaboration of interfaith. I'm not expert on that because I'm not a religious leader. However, I do have a lot of friends, religious leaders.
Right.
And I can safely say I can invite all of them and nobody will raise a complaint or... Because the basis of We Care for Humanity is humanitarianism, doing goodness, whatever religion you are, whatever color, whatever creed, whatever race, we're all equal, we're all humanitarians, we're all helping humanity.
That's interesting.
Yeah, the challenge is, there's always challenge, you know, when you're starting, it's very challenging, people will question your credibility, people will question a lot of things. But once you have established yourself, it's easier. However, still you encounter people who are jealous, envious, which I think is normal. I think it's healthy also to have a little bit of challenges, competition and all.
That way someone else wants
it. You can't please everybody.
But challenge is in a good way to make you grow.
Yeah, yes, I would say. I like that challenge. Yeah.
To do more, like you want to always excel and do more and more.
Yes, you want to prove to them that you meant well.
Do you think the seven laws of Noah could be incorporated as a means to bridge the different cultures?
Oh, definitely. Like I said, I think every religion has the seven laws. It's just that where they are in different positions and there are probably more detailed, but the seven laws are sort of generic, you know, general. It's a summary of everything that we need to do to have peace in this world.
And the Torah, for that matter, is compared to like a light, a beacon, and it shines and illuminates the world with peace and
absolutely. I mean, if people ask me, I mean, even if it, for example, there you don't call it seven laws of Noahide, I will still follow that because it's exactly what we need, what people need to follow. I mean, believe in God, believe, respect to the divine, not to commit adultery or have whatever,
right.
And respect for human for human lives and all lives, animals,
right.
And all that. I mean, these are really exactly what we need. It's the same with humanitarianism. If you want to do good for other people, first you have to have that basic foundation, which is convert to your faith. It's going to be the seven Noahide laws. But yes, I believe that every person should follow that one. If they can, then are they can be a great human being.
And we could live together
peacefully.
Yes. I think New York is the one place on the earth where you have every culture, mm-hmm. every religion, all people living together. And we live on an island.
Yes.
And we manage to do it. We may honk the horns a bit loud, we may scream at each other a bit, but I think overall we get along over here.
That's good. We need that. We need...
I think the world is also becoming a global village, meaning...
Correct.
It's what's happening in the Philippines, what's happening in Syria, good or bad, it's all exposed.
And the hope of humanity, basically, is humanitarianism. I always say that because, you know, we need to learn how to give, care, share. Who else will help us but us, one another? I mean, the government doing their job, but they can't really help everybody. That's why we have NGOs. That's why we have all these other entities that
people
are doing.
Yeah,
yeah, the people. We need to be open. We need to learn that stop being selfish, and we need to think of others as well. Then I think we have higher rate of survival. Then peace will happen automatically, and eradication of poverty will happen automatically. Human rights, there will be all justice for everybody.
It's very true.
Yeah.
So, you know, I want to thank you for your time. This is very, you know, this is a very special show for you.
Thank you, Rabbi Yakov.
You know, to grace us with your
I heard your some of your interviews. I mean, I thought I'm going to be in a battle.
No.
I was looking forward to it.
This is something which is really, this is a shedding some light onto New York, and for that matter, the rest of the world, to illuminate with goodness and kindness. Because that's what it's about. You're an ambassador or a princess of goodness and kindness.
Thank you so
much. Which is really what it's about. Being each of every one of us in our own way could be that.
Everybody will be should be ambassador.
Ambassador
of
goodness and kindness.
Kindness.
Right. Because that is the ultimate. Because then we emulate God.
Yes.
And we unite and bring peace and harmony into the world.
Absolutely.
And that's what it's about. Bringing that. Is that hope, you know, for us, for kids in Africa, from children in the Middle East, from wherever they are, from the challenges that they have in America, or wherever they are, everyone has their unique challenges that they have to overcome.
Absolutely.
And if we could show them that there's light at the end of the tunnel, and it's not an oncoming train, meaning it's there's challenges, but challenges are there to make us grow.
We can, and there is hope for peace, there is hope for humanity, if we believe and we act on it.
So we have to act on it,
yeah.
And you know, I think we have a few more minutes, so we'll just, if you want to talk about some of your, you know,
yeah.
we know we have to sort of wrap it up, so I guess.
Okay, so well, thank you so much.
I thank you, I guess we're going to have, if someone wants to contact the princess, please contact Princess. She's We Care for Humanity.
WeCareForHumanity.org,
yeah.
And PrincessMaria.com. We're on Facebook. Just type in Princess Maria or The Traveling Princess.
The Traveling Princess.
We Care for Humanity. I have my full name there too, Maria Leonora Torres. Very long name. But or you can Google me.
Google.
I'm
she's actually very likable.
I'm on Wikipedia too.
Right. Wikipedia and please...